And even how we approach worship. The worship is about story, you know, and it's about all of us. I mean, we use videos. We do all kinds of things to connect with all of who we are. I'm going to just jump with the sound, right? But, you know, sound connects with us. And we do the music. We have our table back here to help us to connect. We use the water, the stones. There's an important thing about touch that helps us connect with God. When we light the candles, the light, or the smoke that rises up, all those things are part of it. Churches use incense because even smell does that. How many of you have smelled something that has connected you back to something maybe in your childhood? It could be good, it could be bad, but right away, you're there, you know? We were putting up our camper to loan to Christy's brother. They're going camping out in the Dakotas for a week, about 10 days or something. And I opened up and smelled it, like, oh, that camping feel, you know, everything kind of melts away. Right? So all of it connects with us. And even the way we use our body. Raise your hands up like this once. Put your head back. How many of you feel more open? Right? Put your arms like this. Wrap yourself up with your head down. Right? How many of you feel more loved right now? Right? If you bow your head down like this, how many of you sense more of this humility, of this meekness? Right? The way we use our body connects to it. This whole being, all of it is important for who we are and how we connect with God. And even the music. Now, you know, we use different instruments. You know, it used to be a fellow you can only use the organ. And all kinds of instruments connect with God. But often we still are just using Christian music. I want to just do a really quick, we'll start this and we'll see how far we go with it, guys. We can click on, this is a verse from Acts 1 where Luke says, in the first volume of this book, his first volume was Luke, the second is Acts, he said, I wrote everything that Jesus, on everything Jesus began to do and teach. See, the whole life of Jesus we have, up through his death and resurrection, is just what he began to do. And say that God is about this story that continues, that we're part of that, of what Jesus continues to do. Through this next book here, I want to talk about what we use. Keep going. Thank you. Anybody know this song? Who is this? No? Just turn it down, maybe not. What group is this? Come on, anybody. Guys, the band? Yes, you too. We got the, yeah. You too. And the song is what? I still haven't found what I'm looking for. I think it's a lot like the Rod Stewart moment, you know. But or a few weeks, some weeks ago, we used Rolling Stones, right? Can't get no satisfaction. Say, you know what? We use this music that centers like I would say, but out there, people are singing and they're like saying, where is God? Where is meaning found? So I haven't found what I'm looking for. I still haven't found. Let's click on, because otherwise we'll just be singing this and they won't be paying attention. I know, we can play it again, maybe at the end of the service, we'll see. Clip on, guys, click on, thank you. We need to be open to God in all these different places, in the music, the people around us, and the things we hear. And maybe it's not the band and have to do that, although they don't, you know. Even the license they have for worship only covers contemporary Christian music, so we'll have to work on it. There's other things that work too. I want to come to our end here, but I think this really is important for how we live out in the world. And we often, you know, we've been taught often that church is just about Sunday morning, and I think this is a much broader thing. When I went to India some years ago, when I first came to Beloit, went with Lutheran World Relief to work with people in some of the most difficult places in the world. Saw my first leper. We've only heard of it, to actually see someone who's going through this. And I remember talking to leaders there, and they said, you know, some churches, especially those in the evangelical tradition, they will only go into countries where they can also preach their message to the people. Like, you know, it's kind of like if you've ever been to some of the soup kitchens or places like that, homeless shelters, that before they let you come in, you got to sit down and listen to their spiel, and then you can eat. And said, what they found is, what the people's response is, you know, you really don't care about me, you just want to convert me. So they said, they weren't going to do it that way. They were going to go in and they were going to help people, you know, to stand for themselves, to get what they needed, without having to give their spiel. He said, what they found was something very interesting. They said that the people would come to them and say, you know, what kind of God do you worship that you would do these things for me? You know, I said that just in their actions, they showed what God was like. And it reminded me of the words of St. Francis of Assisi, who said, preach the good news of God and use words only if you really have to. Right? That people are looking for what we're doing and they see in us. And I think that's very important. Because, you know, like that bumper sticker we talked about a few weeks ago said, you know, God, deliver me from your followers. You know, this is that the people love God. People are, Jesus is something someone they see and say, you know, that resonates with me, but those people follow him, they just kind of make me nervous. And I think we need to wrestle with this, and I think it needs to go beyond to just these things, even in political realm. And I'm going to lift this up because this is the 4th of July weekend, and I'm going to finish with a story if you'll bear with me. When I was in internship, it was in a church in the inner city of Milwaukee, and like most churches, they have an American flag in the sanctuary. Most churches, people don't even think about it, it's just the way that they do it. We don't, because we think that's something that's not a central thing of worship. Worship is something that goes beyond our nation, you know, and those allegiances. But I remember the pastor at the time, his son was in his mid-teens, and I believe it was schizophrenia, but it's about the time and age when those things come on, and he was getting medication for this, but he had stopped taking it, and he had disappeared one evening, and no one knew where he was. And so the next morning, during worship, his father was preaching. He came in from the back of the church. He had been gone all night, no one knew where, and he came and sat in the front row, and in the middle of the sermon, he went up to that flag, and he pushed it on the floor, and then he went and sat down. Now, I believe the people in the congregation knew something about this. It's kind of hard to be the pastor without people understanding something of what's going on in your family. But one of the ushers quietly put the flag back up. The young man went right back, but he pushed on the floor again. This older gentleman who was sitting behind me, who I knew had been in the Navy World War II, he always was telling stories about it, came rushing up, and he decked this kid in the middle of worship. Sent him right to the floor. His father came down from the pulpit. The ushers came and took the kid out. And then this young man who was sitting right in front of me, who I knew was in the Marines, and you know, really tough-looking kid, you know, the real short hair, crew cut, and he went out with his hands were just clenched, and he was beat red, and it looked like he was going to go track the kid down and just beat him to a pulp. And I think someone must have caught him on the way and talked him out of it. But it really shook all of us there. I mean, that in the middle of this place of worship of the God we talk about is the crucified God who was killed by the state, we're decking people over, pushing the flag down. I think we really need to wrestle with this because we've done the same thing with this whole sacred and secular and you know, religion and God and nation to say, you know, we need to think about it. These aren't separate realms. If God is in it all, then what does that mean? How do we deal with it? Because do we just accept everything? Or do we have to wrestle with that too and say, how is God in the midst of all these things? And what does that mean if our allegiance is first to God and everything is sacred and everyone is sacred? You know, part of what we're doing this week with this mission trip, I think, is inviting those of us who are going to go into that realm. To not see this about just being Sunday morning for an hour or an hour and a half or whatever time it is that we're gathered together here. To see that it's a 24/7 thing, that God is in everything and how we live matters. You know, and what people see us doing matters. And then we're not going there just to care for someone, but also to have our lives transformed to see God beyond. I'm going to invite those who are going on the trip to stand now where they are. We're going to let you stay where you are. We want to do a commission and a blessing and be able to lift it for you. So go ahead, guys. Why don't you pray? Please stand. Stand for peace. Thank you. You know, you stay standing, guys. Stay standing. Yeah, we're gonna do a little blessing. If you're by one of them, if you want to, you can put a hand on the shoulder or on the head to bless them on their trip. God, we thank you that you have called us to go to places beyond, and we ask that you would bless these youth and all those who are going on this trip, that they might find that you are in everything, find that you have called them to live that out in all they do, even though sometimes, like the young man in the story, we struggle with that, we resist, all of us. We ask that you would bless them as they go, but also that you would open us to see that you call us to the same places, to go beyond ourselves and to find you in the midst of everyone we meet. So be with them now, but be with us all as we support them too. And we ask that you would do this, Jesus, in your name. Amen. You guys can go ahead and sit down. You know, I really want to challenge us because, you know, one of the things youth works group we're going with us is they do trips for families as well. You know, we usually do this as a youth thing. We want them to have that experience. We say, well, you know what, why shouldn't we as adults be experiencing God is out there? Go ahead, pass this one, guys. This is the last story. But I think we need to go beyond just going on trips and to say, you know, what does it mean that we as a church live in this world where everything is not secular, where everything is sacred? And next week we want to explore that more as we explore living in community. Next slide, thanks guys. Next one up. Next week's message will be living as community. And what does that mean as we reclaim Jesus' message for everyone?